from Simon & Schuster Audio, Blackbird, A Childhood Lost, written and read by Jennifer Lauck.
UCLA Medical and Clinics. Death Summary. Lauck Janet L. Admitted, August 25, 1971. Expired, September 19, 1971. Present illness. This is the sixth UCLA hospital admission for this 33-year-old white female. The patient presented to the emergency room with a 5 to 7 day history of weakness, fatigue, cough, and left anterior chest pain. Her significant past medical history began in 1961 with removal of a benign tumor. She had a reoccurrence of the tumor in 1968 with another neurosurgical procedure. She then developed paralysis, neurogenic bladder, and recurrent urinary tract infections. She was hospitalized in February 1970 for an overdose and again in February 1971 because of a duodenal ulcer. She was again hospitalized in May 1971 for septic shock, secondary to a left pneumonia and an empyema of the urinary bladder. Hospital course. This patient was admitted with numerous medical problems, bilateral pneumonia, sepsis, and severe metabolic acidosis and severe hypokalemia. The patient had a catheter placed in the left subclavian vein. By her first night in the hospital, she rapidly went into respiratory arrest and was resuscitated with intubation. Chest film taken after resuscitation reveals a large left-sided pneumothorax. A left-sided chest tube was placed with re-expansion of the lung. The patient seemed to be improving, however, she rapidly deteriorated pulmonary-wise with the development of what was felt to be adult respiratory distress syndrome. The patient had a tracheostomy performed and seemed to improve on this regimen, however, continued to have difficulty with the left-sided pneumothorax, with repeated malfunction and replacement of chest tubes. The patient died suddenly in the morning of 9/19/71. The immediate cause of the death was felt to be respiratory arrest. However, arrhythmia could not be ruled out. Edited dictation and transcription, resident of medicine, UCLA Hospital.
Part 1. Carson City, Nevada, 1969.
The only house I'll ever call home is the one on Mary Street. Mary Street is in Carson City, Nevada, and Carson City is flat valley to soft hills. Past the hills are the Sierra Nevada mountains. When you look up, the sky is deep blue, forever blue, and there are almost never any clouds up there. The clouds that do come gather on top of the Sierras, and they look like wadded-up tissue paper. Every now and then, a piece of cloud will tear away and float across the forever blue sky. There's one main street right down the middle of the city, and it's called Carson Street. The state capitol building is on Carson Street, and the dome of the capitol is painted silver since Nevada is a silver state. Over the silver dome, two flags kick the wind, one blue for Nevada, one red, white, and blue for America. The Golden Nugget is on Carson Street, too, but everyone just calls it the Nugget. From the Nugget, you go a couple blocks, and you can see the house where Auntie Carol and Uncle Bob live with a pack of my wild cousins. There's Stephen, Bobby Lou, Andy, Mark, Tracy, and Faith Ann. Auntie Carol is Daddy's older sister, and the only time I go to that house is for holidays or if Mama has to see a special doctor. West of Auntie Carol's house, you go Iris Street, Angus Street, and then it's Mary Street, and our house is the one with the white fence and the big willow tree. When you come in the front door, there's three ways you can go. Straight ahead is the living room, right is the kitchen, and left is a long hallway to bedrooms and bathrooms. The first bedroom is BJ's, and then it's the bathroom, and then it's my room. Mama and Daddy's room is at the end of the hall, and out their window you can see the big willow tree. If the sun is just right, the shadow of the tree comes into their room and lies right over the middle of the California king. Mama says the bed is called that because it's not as wide as a regular king and just a little longer like the state. Next to the California king is a pair of silver crutches, the kind you adjust tall or short by pushing in a little silver bead. Mama can stand up without the crutches, and she can even take a couple of steps. She still has to use the crutches when she walks to the bathroom or when she goes to any other part of our house. There was a time when Mama walked just like everyone else, when she was only in bed at night, when she drove her car and talked on the telephone and had lots of ladies over for card games and coffee and thick slices of banana nut bread. I remember when Mama was strong enough to lift me off my feet, toss me in the air, and catch me again. There's never been a time when I haven't been home with Mama. Daddy works, BJ goes to school, and it's just Mama and me all day, every day. In the morning, I sit outside her door and listen. That's the rule. Moshi and Diana wait, too. Moshi is one of those fast-moving crazy cats. Diana is all liquid in weight. I pet Diana's soft sand-colored tummy and lay my head against the wall. Moshi sits apart from us, his brown head held high, blue eyes half closed. The rule is no cats, no kids, not until the toilet flushes. When the toilet finally flushes, Moshi runs to the door, Diana rolls away from my hand, and I get off the floor and walk to the kitchen. The kitchen is 18 steps from Mama's bedroom door. I drag a chair from the kitchen table to the counter, climb up, and lift the coffee pot with both hands so I don't spill. Daddy makes the coffee before he leaves for work, and he sets out Mama's special cup so I can fill it. The cup is white and the lightest color of yellow, garlands of tiny purple and red flowers painted around the outside, a line of gold around the inside. The cup and saucer are part of our china kept in the hutch for special occasions. Mama says she likes coffee in special china, says it makes her feel pampered. 4 slices of bread in the toaster, and I press the toast button down. I cut off 4 squares of real butter, put them on the side of the plate. The toast hops up, and I stack the 4 slices cut diagonal with a butter knife and put the toast next to the butter. Mama says presentation is everything. I spoon into a jar of marmalade, thin orange slices swimming in the jam, 1, 2, 3 spoons next to the toast and butter. Mama says the marmalade is from Carmel, California, which is her most favorite place in the whole world. I put the plate on a tray with the cup of coffee and the special china. 1 foot in front of the other, I walk extra slow so I don't spill. When I get to her room, Moshi and Diana are up on the California King, cat bodies around and around, and Mama pets with both hands. "Good morning, sunshine," she says. The best part of seeing Mama is how she always calls me sunshine and how there's that look in her dark brown eyes. It's one of those special looks for special people. Mama has that special look for Daddy, too, but I mostly see it when she looks at me, and when she looks at me that way, I know I can do just about anything. After toast and coffee, Mama lets me brush her dark curly hair, and it's fine and soft between my fingers. One time she showed me a photo of Mrs. Kennedy in Life magazine. Mama calls her Jackie, says the former First Lady is bursting with style. She wants her hair just like in the magazine, and I make the part on the side, brush all her curls into 1 curl just under her chin. "Does Mrs. Kennedy have curly hair too?" I say. "That's a very good question," Mama says. "I don't think so." Mama holds the mirror and watches me pat the last curl in place. "Ready?" she says. I cover my eyes and hold my breath. "Ready." Mama sprays a cloud of Aquanet, and it's a smell of hairspray and that sticky mist on my hands and legs. The hairspray makes Moshi shake his head, and that's when he jumps off the bed and disappears until tomorrow morning. Diana doesn't care about hairspray, rolls over on her back and takes up the sunbeam Moshi left behind. "Getting put together is more than hair," Mama says. She always says getting put together like she fell apart overnight. Mama leans over, opens the top drawer of the nightstand, and she takes out the black and white zip-up cosmetic bag. Mama dumps her makeup out on her lap and lines the cosmetics in order, compact powder, a tube of rouge, eyeliner, and lipstick. She picks up the powder compact, snaps open the lid, and inside is a soft round pad. Mama rubs the pad over the pressed powder and moves the pad under her eyes, over her nose, and up her cheeks and down her chin. Mama touches her face so light, it's almost like she doesn't touch at all. "Just a whisper of powder does the trick," she says. "Too much and you look like a clown." Mama taps the pad of powder to my nose, and that always makes me laugh. When I laugh, Mama laughs too, and the sound is better than music. After the powder, Mama taps rouge high on her cheekbones and rubs the color until it's the lightest shade of pink. "Rouge is like a trick on Mother Nature," Mama says. "It gives that flush, fresh look, even when you're not." The best part of getting put together is when she does her eyes. Mama has the kind of eyes that are so dark they take in light and make it dark too. Mama says eyes never lie, and if you know how to look just right, you can always find the truth in another person by watching their eyes. When I look at Mama, I mostly see that special look like she's happy I'm here. I know there are other things going on inside that she doesn't say, but I'm still learning how to look just right. Mama takes the tube of eyeliner, shakes it like a thermometer, and pulls out the long wand. Her hand is steady, and she makes a thin line to the outside of one eye and then the other. After the eyeliner is dry, Mama looks me dead on, and her eyes are even darker, which doesn't seem possible. "Nice," Mama says. "Perfect," I say. The finishing touch is lipstick, and I always get to put it on. Mama gives me the tube of lipstick, and I take a deep breath, hold my hand steady, and fill in her lips with the red color. When I'm done, I let out my breath again and hand back the tube of lipstick. Mama pulls two tissues from the box on the nightstand, folds the tissues in half, and then half again. She presses her mouth around the tissues, and some of the red comes off in the shape of her mouth. "Nice," she says. "Perfect," I say. If it's a bad day, Mama puts her cosmetics away and stays in bed. If it's a good day, she pushes her covers back and puts her feet on the floor. Today is a good day. "Can you get me my robe, sunshine?" Mama says. Mama wears matching nightgowns and robes called peignoir sets, and they're all different colors of yellow, pink, and peach. Today it's a creamy yellow lemon meringue, and I hold her robe in my hands, the silk like water in my fingers. One arm, the other arm, twist, shrug, and then Mama stands up so she can pull the robe around her legs. Mama shimmies a little under her own weight, and I move close, help tug the silk so the robe falls around her feet. She sits down heavy on the end of the bed and takes a deep breath. When something's wrong, really wrong, my skin knows first. It's a prickly feeling at the back of my neck, over the top of my head, down my forehead and into my nose. Feels like a nosebleed coming on. "You okay?" I say. Mama sits up tall, shoulders straight, chin tucked. She calls sitting like that the posture of a lady. "I'm fine," she says, "just a little dizzy." I look past her words and into her truth, and I know it's not such a good day after all. Mama clears her throat and blinks the truth away. She crosses her legs at the knee, adjusts her robe. "Okay now," Mama says, "take a few steps back and see the big picture." She sits on the edge of the California King, and she's silky lemon meringue, Mrs. Kennedy, dark eyes wide open with that special look she gets when I'm around. "Good," she says. "Perfect. Pretty? You're bursting with style." Mama laughs when I say bursting with style, and it's music in her room. There's no special time for taking pills. Mama opens and closes bottles all day. Mostly aspirin, but there are others too. Yellow pills, red pills.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.